wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. But he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. But let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Reading this, God gave me the title of the message, Unfamiliar Territory. I talked to my mom about the message, and she was like, well, it's Mother's Day. Shouldn't it be like a Mother's Day message? And I thought about it, and whenever I think of Mother's Day, I think of like a happy time, a joyful time, a celebration. But in April, I lost my grandmother. And the ladies of the church, as sweet as they are, they gave us these ribbons to represent, you know, the red ones were for the people who still had their mothers around, and the white ones were for those who did not. And as I saw my mom the first time grab that white ribbon, I realized that Mother's Day for some of us is unfamiliar territory, because it's the first Mother's Day without your mom. Or it may be the first Mother's Day and the mom is here, but her children have passed away. And so, in other words, we find ourselves in unfamiliar territory. As James is writing in the first chapter, verses 5-8, he's writing to Jewish Christians who have been scattered abroad, and we find that in James 1:1, which says, James, the servant of God, and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad. So he was writing to people who were in unfamiliar territory. David has been working a part-time job with Delta for about 2.5 years. And so, you know, working for Delta, a part-time job is a good thing, but a full-time job is a great thing. And so it's kind of hard to come by. It's a really, really awesome opportunity. Just the benefits of nature, and basically in order to get into a position with Delta, you wait for somebody to either get fired, to die, to retire, or something like that. And so we applied and prayed and asked God, and he opened up this door to go to New York, which is great. But you find yourself in unfamiliar territory. And so as I read the scripture in James, God encouraged me, and he told me, he said, whenever you find yourself in unfamiliar territory, what you can take from James is 3 points. Asking for what you need, ask in faith, and ask considering the posture of your prayer. When you ask God for whatever you need, James was writing to them to ask for wisdom because he knew that the children of Israel were scattered in a place that was unfamiliar to them. And there were different types of wisdom out there that could sway them or turn them away from their God. And he actually writes later on in the fourth chapter, he says, the wisdom not descended from above is earthly, sensual, and devilish. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, and easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. James knew that in order for those Jewish Christians to produce that godly behavior, they had to first go to God. So for you, it may be, I need courage. Pastor and many other ministers have been talking to us about evangelism, but it's like, Lord, how do I go out? You know, what do I say? If your request in unfamiliar territory is, how do I evangelize to someone who may be of a homosexual lifestyle or a child who has been molested, and they come to you and they're going through something and you find yourself in unfamiliar territory, Lord, what do I say to this person? James is saying, when you want to know what to say and you want to honor God, ask him. Ask him. The next point we go into is asking faith. When James was writing, and it was so awesome because as you're reading, God would begin to just open up your eyes and open up your mind to different things. And when reading the first chapter, when James writes in the first verse about him writing to the children of Israel scattered abroad, you're just like, oh, that's a cool intro. But it's not until you get down later when God explains, I wanted you to know who he was writing to. He wasn't writing to the 12 tribes of a Native American nation or of African nation. He was writing to the children of Israel. And he said to ask in faith. And it wasn't so much about the asking, but you be mindful of who you're asking. I'm not telling you to ask a person who, like us, are human and can be without. I'm telling you to ask God. I'm telling you to ask the one who brought you out of Israel. I'm telling you to ask. I'm sorry, who bought you out of Egypt. I'm telling you to ask the one who brought 10 plagues upon Egypt that Pharaoh may let his people go. I am writing to people who know who God is. And the thing that God brought out to me that encouraged my heart so much is he said, not only did I bring him out of Egypt, not only did I part the Red Sea, those are big, beautiful miracles. He said, but I destroyed the very thing that scared them the most. As you read in Exodus, the Bible talks about how he allowed the Egyptians to come into the Red Sea. And they got their big, bad chariots and their horses and all of that. And everything that would scare you, I think about, you know, the military and how chariots will go by and horses will go by and how that can be an authoritative, intimidating, an intimidating presence. But God said, everything that scares you, first of all, I'm listed so you can see that it is I who destroys it all. Yeah. Everything that scares you in your unfamiliar place, if you are facing, you know, going off to college, or if you have a child who just gone off to college, if it's a new job or just joining a new church, whatever it is that's unfamiliar to you, ask God in faith and realize who you're talking to. You got to realize who you're standing with, or I have to realize who I'm standing with. The last part is to ask in to evaluate the posture of prayer. James said, even though you know who you're talking to in his awesomeness and in his miracles, remember also he's the only one who knows the heart. So don't come and ask me and not believe what you're asking me about. You come to me and tell me to protect you. You ask me if I can be your shield, if I can be your protection, while at the exact same time, you trying to work out a plan on the other side. Lord, you know, I need some money, but I'm sitting up there trying to devise a plan on how to rob a bank. You know what I'm saying? I'm not trusting you. I'm not giving it to you. And in my personal situation right now, with this big move to New York, it's like, okay, Lord, I know, you know, you get all holy and stuff. You're like, Lord, I know that you are going to provide me with a job, I'm going to apply, and this, that, such, and such. But I find myself, you know, kind of like trying to bolt my chair to the floor of my current office because I love my job. Yeah. And he's like, either you don't trust me,
all right, man,
or you're not. But you have to remember who you are trusting. This church has gone through many, many different changes. They've been scary. They're humongous. They're unfamiliar. But one quote that I found while doing this lesson that I love, it was by Alexander Demon, and it says, give me just a second, he says, if you find yourself as a person in unfamiliar territory, you will grasp onto what is already familiar.
That's it.
Say one more time. He said, if you find yourself as a person in unfamiliar territory, you will grasp onto what is already familiar.
Yes.
I got any Christians? Any Christian friends? Right. Anybody here know God? Personal saving?
Yes.
Personal for a reason? He's familiar to you. No matter how unfamiliar your territory may be, no matter how scary or how big it seems, you know him. You know him personally. He has bought us out of so many different things. Take a journal and you write down, whenever you find yourself about to get down, you write down how many bills he's paid you, how many diseases he's healed, how many addictions he's watching for. Whenever you find yourself in unfamiliar territory, you're looking around and I don't know these neighbors, I don't know these people in their doctrine, I don't know this, but I know God. And what I know about God is that God, he will protect me, he will keep me. My husband reminded me last day before the day was that unfamiliar territory came, I would be understand who you stand and pray for. And so I conclude to you, I don't know what your unfamiliar territory may be. For me, and my husband moving to New York. But what is it for you? What is it for you? Consider your heart, Lord, the unfamiliar territory. The things that scare me right now. What Egyptian do I need you to destroy? I am afraid, God. I am unemployed, God. I need a car, God. I need comfort because my mom passed, God. I need hope because I'm hopeless, God. I have family members who are dying the only way to heal and don't want to hear you, God. Unfamiliar territory, God. But you are familiar to me. Help me. It's everything that I am and everything that I have to grasp onto you, not with my words, but with my lips. Evaluate. If a prayer has not been answered, God, why? It's not because you're not good. James has been writing to them to tell them to get upset when their prayers aren't answered, but he asks them to evaluate you. If you don't get this prayer answered, why not? Lord, did I trust you? Because you told me that if I trust in you with all of my heart, if I lean not to my own understanding, if I acknowledge you in all my ways, you will direct my path, and I don't have direction. Lord, why? Evaluate me. Search me and know my heart and remove anything that's in me that's not like you. I love y'all. God bless y'all. When you find yourself in unfamiliar new territory, this is going to be your familiar God.
Praise you. It's in Jesus' name, amen. Discipleship offering.